Alright, as promised, I'm going to show you how to turn one of these, and one of these into a Naomi game machine. Now, I'll just list off some stuff you're going to need. Now, some of this stuff may be optional depending on who you know and what you know and how much you're willing to pay for stuff. Start off with the basics. Compact flash cards. 128 meg will do for most games. Only a couple, I think, that exceed 128. And in that case, they're only 256 or maybe 512. But 128 should do. They're pretty hard to get as 128. I've got a 2 gig one floating about here, which I'm going to try Marvel vs. Capcom 2 on when I'm done here as part of the tutorial. Apart from that, you're going to obviously need a Naomi system, which is on the floor here. The Naomi will need to have a BIOS of, I think, G or later. Now, the one I recommend is Japan H BIOS. To burn this, you can either get it done from someone else, or you can use a brand new EEPROM and burn it yourself with a half-decent EEPROM burner like this one, GQ4X. This one requires an adapter to use it, though. All up, you're looking at about $120, I think, for that and the adapter. If you don't want to buy a new EEPROM, even if you do, you're probably going to need an eraser as well. I have one on the floor. You probably can't really see that, but let's zoom into it. There it is. It costs like 10 bucks, that blue plastic thing. It doesn't need to be a good one, it just needs to work. If you have a UV lamp, for I think snakes use UV lamps, or even disinfecting stuff with UV lamps, you can use that instead, because all you need to do is rip this little sticker off and expose that to UV to erase it. Now, I'm not going to do that. It takes a while anyway, especially under the sunlight. Now, so that's the Naomi part done. On top of that, I said a NetDim with at least 303, but for the firmware, but to make the actual compact flash thing work, you need 4.02, which is a hacked firmware. 3.03 is the minimum for net booting, which you can update, which means you can update it via the network port. I'm not going to show you how to do that. There are thousands of videos online on how to do that, so I'm not going to. Plus, I've never done it before, so up yours. Oops, I left my glue gun plugged in, I think. Yes, I did. That was not clever. Never mind that. For the soldering, half-decent soldering iron, some solder, flux of choice. This is my flux pen. I like the pens. This is no clean, and it's easy to apply on. Now, because you aren't going to actually be soldering to any sensitive electronic, you can use a piece of shit iron. That said, I don't recommend it. This one cost me $100. That's really fucking hot, you idiot. This one cost me $100. This is a temperature-controlled one, and it cost me $100. If you're in Australia, it's a Dick Smith T2200, and you can buy tips that are decently small. I highly recommend it. It is great for $100. Now, for the actual compact flash part of it, you're going to need at least, now I'll explain this, at least one IDE compact flash adapter. Doesn't have to be anything fancy. You could build this yourself if you really wanted to. But if you're going to build it yourself, this whole tutorial is pointless. Well, most of it anyways. This one has a slave and master adapter. I shall explain why my one is on slave and why you need master a bit later. On top of that, you will need a SCSI 2 to IDE 50 adapter. Look, this is one of the ones that go on the back of the PC, sort of look kind of like that. If I had them the right way, I've taken that off. It will also have a IDE plug, much like this one, except 10 more pins on the end. I have taken them off and soldered directly to it, because that's what you need to do. You will also need a very good IDE cable. This one is an 80 core. 40 pin, you need to have a 40 pin one. You can use a 40 core 40 pin, I don't recommend it. Now, if you're wondering what this glue is for, I broke the clip because I'm a fucking idiot and I really don't want to resolder this shit, so hot glue. That's why I burnt my hand. On top of that, you will need some way of powering the flash drive. Now, I have got a 4 pin floppy adapter because that's what this takes that I've cut out of this computer, which I then had to reattach using a different one, long fucking story, and attach it to the official Naomi power supply auxiliary power loom. This one uses also, it's also got a GD-ROM plug and a trackball power plug. The one I cut off was the IO board power plug, which I do not need because it's the same as the GD-ROM thing, and I've already explained how fucking awful that is, because it's wired differently, so I rewired it. Be very careful. If you have this loom and you are wiring, I made this mistake and lost a flash card in the process. If you will look, the yellow is connected to the red, and the red is connected to the yellow. That's because, coming from this, shit, I can't remember actually which one's which. But, as you can see, it's different. 5 volt is 12 volt. I think red on this side is 12, and yellow is 12. So if you put yellow to yellow, you're going 12 to 5 and 5 to 12, which is bad. You do not want to do that. I think that is all for the parts. Let's just check on the floor. Ah, of course. Now, the at least one part of this I'll explain. You cannot use a USB compact flash adapter for right... Well, you can use it. Sorry, I'll explain it again. You need a IDE and I think a SATA or a PCMCIA compact flash adapter to get a security key off your compact flash things, which is basically 2 digits of the serial number. Now, I will show you what happens when you do it on a USB one. I'm just going to plug this in. Okay. Ignore everything on my computer for now. As you can see, it gives you an error. Now, I can show you the extended part, which I really should have set this up a bit better. Just give me a second. I'll copy the command. Now, I'm not going to say I did all this by myself. I most definitely didn't. I pieced together a lot of pieces of a puzzle. It's taken me quite a long time, and I thought I would share some nuggets of knowledge with you. As you can see, it doesn't really help. It's a generic flash adapter. This does not give you enough information for anything, but you can use it to write, providing you have the information, which I do for at least this card. I will explain that in a second. Now, the at least one bit. I'm using this currently as both my Naomi flash adapter and an actual PC flash adapter. I'm just plugging it in. It's just standard PC shit. But my beastie computer that I just built does not have IDE. I was very annoyed. So I'm using this, which is an old P4. You do not need a lot of power to do what this is going to do. You could probably do it on a P2, to be honest, or even less. As long as it runs Windows something, or even Linux. You can do it in Linux. Any computer that runs anything. Now, as for software, you're going to need... And I shall bring up the folder. Naomi CF. It's already running. This is an application to automatically split the files, write the security bits, and do all that fun stuff. I will provide as many links as I deem necessary. Some of this stuff you'll have to Google yourself because it's either illegal or you can't get it anymore. And the only way you can get it is through patched copies just like this. And I'm not going to say that. That was really silly. You're going to need some ROMs. Only download games that you own. Yeah. You'll need MPLAB, which I shall open up for you now, which is a microchip programming environment, MPLABX, version 8.92, sorry. I forgot one more part you need. You need a security chip, which is... I really should have planned this a lot better. 16... Fuck, I can't remember. 16... hang on. My eyes are terrible, so I'll open up. Me, one hand. Look at my screen for a second. Ah, 16F628A, isn't it? Yes, pick 16F628A. You need only one. I recommend getting two in case you break the legs off like I did 3 times because I was screwing around with stuff. I didn't have a remover. I was using my fingers, and that is dumb. I will admit that, but they only cost me like $1, and I only needed one, and I bought 10. So, that's all good. Any other software we need? Well, this is my EEPROM burners one. No biggie. That's it. Pretty sure that's it. Just look in my Anomi folder. Yep. That is it. Okay. Now we'll get into the fun stuff. Where do we start? Let's start with the soldering. Now, I'm not going to show you how to solder this one by one. As I said, I'm going to show you this tutorial and then show you exactly what you need to do as a result of this tutorial. This is from, I'll
endeavour to put this link. It's from PCB Otaku. It's called the Sega CF Box. If you Google it, if I forget the links, it'll be there. Otherwise, it's all over the place anyway. Now, there's this table here. You'll see very clearly you have SCSI 2-pin, SCSI, SCSI, whatever, IDE pin. Basically, you... Now, before I explain that, you can see exactly the way the pinouts are here. Oh, excuse me. Now, where's the SCSI cable? As you can see, this is your stock standard GD-ROM SCSI cable, and it's, these are male pins, okay? Both sides male pins. So, according to that, from the top left you have pin 1 to pin 25, then on the bottom left, pin 26 to pin 50. Now, you can correspond that to the other end of the adapter, which I've lost. There it is. So you can see it on there. These are the female pins, so that is that one there. 1 through 25 and 26 through 50. Use a multimeter. I really recommend, if you don't have a multimeter, go buy one with audible continuity, so it beeps when it detects a trace. Very good for debugging and shit. Now, this one's a very interesting design. I have no idea why they did it like that, probably because... I don't fucking know. Actually, no, it makes sense now, sorry. Pin 1 is here, then goes through there. It comes out there, and is over there. So that's pin 1, even though that's pin 1. And then that's pin 2, even though that's pin 2. You get the idea. So be very careful with that. That's why a multimeter comes in very handy at this point. Now, the IDE pins. As you can see, if I plug this cable into... I'm not even going to use that cable. Here's my other cable. I apologize for my not very good setup. Okay. You see, if you plug it in. Alright, so you got your notch. Apologies for that. I don't know why I plugged it in. You have the notch at the top there on this particular one, and there's your notch there. So that's pin 1. Pin 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, then 39, 40. Line it up with the pins on this thing. Now, because this is an 80 core cable, there's 80 wires for 40 pins, so every odd number is a ground pin. We don't use those. So red, the red line, that is pin 1. That's it, pin 1. So pin 1 through pin 80 actually corresponds to ground for 1, then line 1, ground for 2, then line 2, all the way up to ground for line 40 and line 40. So that's how you join it up like this. So you start along and you get pin 1, so pin ground 1, 1. So I split it up into lots of two cables and stripped off all the ends for every cable I was going to use and cut the rest off. You get this tangled mess. There are a lot neater ways to do this. I'm not going to lie, this is not neat. But you're looking to save money. These go for about $125 to $150 to even more dollars. This is, I think, about $4 for this bit. About $6 for this bit. This I pulled out of an old computer. So you're saving a lot of money doing this yourself, trust me. So basically, you line up your SCSI pin, so the one off here, to your ID pin, the one on this end. So SCSI pin 5 goes to ID pin 2, SCSI pin 6 goes to ID pin 37, etc. You do that for all the wires that need hooking up. You don't need to do anything else. These all say what these things do and all this other crap. You don't need to worry about that. In the case of a proper bought one, it's only expecting IDE and only expecting data. So you can just feed data straight into it. If you're building one with just a compact flash adapter assembly and you're building your own circuit board, then yeah, you need to understand this crap. But you don't, because this is already set up properly for you. Now, when you're finished doing that, I recommend you double and triple check things with a continuity meter or a multimeter. That was the hardest part for me, because there's so many little wires and I kept miscounting things and stuff. I had to resolder some things 2 or 3 times. If I could find the one I really fucked up on. Yeah, you can see that I've actually had to... Ugh. The pad's actually been destroyed and I had to solder it onto the point. Not such a big deal, and the wires are a bit long, but nothing's touching. So that's good. So this is the hard part to build. Just this. Everything else is piss easy. There's no more building to do after you do this. You can put your soldering iron away, put your hot glue gun away, and you're done. Now, the next bit involves
this, your compact flash card. I'll go back a step. You can look up the 4-pin floppy power out, which is this one here. On the back, you can do two things. You can rip this off and put your standard GD-ROM 6-pin cable on it. Oh, I can't be asked doing that, so I just added on the 4-pin power connector. As I said, you can look up the pins, but if you cut it off an old computer, it becomes pretty obvious what they are and where they go. So the next thing you need to do is actually hook up either an IDE, a SATA, or a PCM-CIA compact flash adapter to a computer. You need to do this. You cannot use a USB one. You cannot skip this step. Okay? I'm going to hook this one up. Now, as you can see, I got this. This is your master-slave switch. If you don't know IDE and how it works, there are... So this is the other end of that cable that I've cut off. So basically, this end of the cable that I've cut off here goes towards the motherboard. This goes to one device. This goes to the other. This pin here selects which one is the master, so which one goes on the first bit, which one's a slave, which one goes on the second bit. So you have two things. Now, because this computer down here is hooked up with a hard drive that's set to master, which is my boot drive, I've set this to slave just for this particular occasion. Give me a second while I plug this shit in. I really hope I'm not rambling too much. I'm going into this kind of off the top of my head. Well, it's still fresh. I've been doing this the last couple of days. Alrighty. And make sure you plug in your compact flash adapter, especially if it's your compact flash card. If it's a IDE one, because IDE is not hot swap. Alright, so we'll try my 2-gig card. Fire it on. Gotta love my setup, eh? Come on, focus. Doesn't want to focus. Ugh. There we go. So I got a computer on the floor hooked up to a TV, got a computer on the desk hooked up to two monitors, and it's a fucking sty everywhere else. It's an absolute mess. I've been cleaning up, but I am not finished. So. The reason I haven't booted this up yet is because it's not hot swappable and I wanted to show you stuff. So I had to unplug the thing. Now, there's a program you need. Called, what is it called? Smart control something. Smart monitoring tools. Ugh. Which it's there. Smart monitoring tools. You need to download and install this. I believe it works for Windows. Yeah, Windows, Mac, Linux. It works for everything. So get that. I'll endeavor to put a link, but if not, that, or Google that. This is a command line application for the most part. So. Fire up your command line. Now I have the command written here. This is from what I understand about how this works. So that runs the program, it reads the data. This is set, I think this is telling it it's a ATA thing, and it's, I think that says compact flash. -i, and it defines the drive letter. In Linux it's dev/sd, whatever. In this case it's coming up as C drive for whatever reason. So we run it as C drive. Okay, then it does this. What you want to do, scroll up. Now, there are two bytes that you want. There is 37 and 38. Those two there, if you can see. Okay. So if you, in this case, it's the third line, fifth one, and sixth one over. Now, these two bits are the security bits we're going to need. Now, the thing you need to know about this is they are byte swapped. So, 34, 39 is the code, not 39, 34. Now that you have that, you don't actually need this computer anymore. Now this is only if you do not have IDE in your main computer. You can skip this part if you have an IDE, SATA, PCMCIA, CF card in a computer where you can run the next program for. This is only the long way of doing it. I do not have IDE in my main computer. I can't be asked copying ROMs onto this computer. So hence the situation. So it's 34. 39. So let's turn this off before I start unplugging shit. Turn off this TV. Wait for it to turn off. Give me a second to unplug. You can watch my mouse. Come on. Okay. So now at this point, 34, 39, You should probably write it down. I'm going to put it in the program. Okay. At this point, I'm going to plug my compact flash reader back in. It's in my monitor, so... Oh, shit. My apologies. I dropped another compact flash card on the floor somewhere. Where did it go? There it is. My apologies for pointing you at the ground. I just dropped a bunch of shit. So, it has come up. Now, if you have your PCM CIA, fuck off. Your PCM CIA SATA or IDE card in your main computer, you can just click, you can open up this Naomi CF application and just click Get ID. But as you can see, it gives you an error. Now, SATA, I am not 100% sure it will work. I have ordered two, they are not here yet. IDE definitely works. USB definitely does not. So I already know it's 3439. Now, we select our ROM, which is going to be Marvel vs. Capcom 2, because I really want to play that. And we click Flash. It does its thing. That's it for making the CF card. Did it remove my ID? Oh, I hope not. We will see. Now, the next bit is probably the bit I spent the longest time on, because mostly because I didn't understand it, because I didn't read it. Then I went through and read it and understand what was going on. And then I kind of got it right. This part stumped me too, because I didn't read about the Get ID part. I thought it was automatic. But, well, it is. But I didn't have the thing hooked up. I was trying to do it through USB, so it wasn't working. Okay. The next thing you will need, you'll need this link. This is a link to the MAME... I think it's from MAME. It's a decompilation of a security IC. Yeah. That has been... I'm just going to reflash this with the code. It changed it again. Why is it changing it? I don't know why it's changing it. I wasn't doing that before. I'll figure it out later. I'll use my other one if that's the case. This is 3538, I think, my other one. Anyway, so this is a decompilation of a security IC. We need to recompile this with a zero code. Now, I cannot find the hex for this, which is what you burn to an EEPROM, anywhere on the internet. Not a single place. So, I'm going to show you how to do it. You need to have the MP Lab as before. Let's start a new project, okay? New file. I'm just going to quickly reflash this again. Give me a sec. Is it 3439? Yeah, it keeps changing it back. I don't know what's going on with that. Alright, I'm just going to try it with my other one in a sec. It doesn't matter. Give me a second just to clear this out of the way. And get another IC out. Because I forgot this part. I don't even know if I have any more. Alright, so this is a 16F628A chip that I got from, I don't know, that's the barcode number though, if you can look it up. I don't trust that, we'll try it again. Let's burn Ikaruga again, sorry. Burning Ikaruga with a different ID to another card. So that one doesn't change. So I don't know what's going on there. Ikaruga is a very good test game if you want to just use it. It's small, it loads quickly. The only thing you have to do is you have to change the assignment to a horizontal monitor. But, you know, whatever. So basically, back to the IC. What we're going to do is we're going to go to this page. I will not provide a link, but there it is. If you Google it, one of the other links I have anyway will provide it to you. And we're going to copy it from down the bottom because it's just easy to control A from there. We're going to paste it into a new file and we're going to save it as an ASM file. ASM is assembly, that is the programming language. Now, there's a couple of things you need to change and I'm going to explain all of them to you. It says it up here too. There's a function called A key code, a function called B key code, and a function called file name. Now, so let's go to the function A key code. So that's not it, that's not it, that's it. Now, let's move you over a bit. Basically, this is the decryption key, I believe, for your Naomi ROM. As you can see, there are two lines here. The first one is for, I think, Guilty Gear XX. That's on the website. I don't know which one it is. The second one is for decrypted ones. As you can see, it's all zeros. So what we want to do, we want to comment out. And the commenting out means it doesn't actually compile it when we compile. So we want to comment out the Guilty Gear one and uncomment the null one. Now, for the B key code, we want to do the same thing. This one here is the first 2 bytes of the DES key. No idea what that means. Comment that out and put the null one back in. Now, the file name. This one comes more sense when I do this, okay? As you can see, this abc.bin is a 256-byte file. I'm guessing it's like some kind of header to point to the game thing and you give you all the information. As you can see, the default for Guilty Gear is BGB, but abc.bin is what Naomi CF here will write to a card, as you can see. The 5, I think, defines something else. I'm not entirely sure. We want to uncomment the ABC, comment out the BGB. Now, this next part, if you don't understand how assembly works and how these picks work, might make it not make a lot of sense. This whole thing might not make a lot of sense, but I'm going to show you anyway. Let's save that off. Now, there's a lot of NOPs. NOP basically means no operation in assembly, so it does nothing. Now, how this pick here works, 16F628A, is there is a four-digit number at the end. It's the oscillator number, which basically is like a unique identifier. Without it, these chips will not work. But the security chips do not have this. So, this is actually 4 bytes too long. No operation happens to be 2 bytes. It does nothing. We can comment them out. I'll show you what happens when you don't comment them out, you try to build. So in this case, make sure you go project, build configuration is set to release, and just click make or build all. What? I haven't set the, there's one more thing I've forgotten to do. There's a button to set. Something. It's not building the right thing, hang on. That's why. Okay, sorry. I'm not very good with this particular IDE. It's trying to build the other project I had open, so I'm just going to reopen that and go from there. Let's close and open up this again. Apologies, I'm kind of fumbling through this. I didn't remember what I did in the first place. But let's... let's add this file to the project that we just had, which is untitled. Ugh. There is a button to make a project. A project wizard, there we go. So you guys select your device. So I'm going to go through that again. Project and project wizard is what you need to do at the start. I greatly apologize. I forgot about this. So select the pick device. Leave that all as default. And the new project file will be... add existing files. I'm going to add my untitled ASM. Wherever that is gone. There it is. Right, that's better. Okay, so make sure the project configuration is release. That's fine, hit F10 to make. Leave this as absolute, it doesn't really matter. It should be giving you an error. It was giving me an error before, unless it didn't save the NBIN. Okay. Unless I commented out the wrong thing, hang on. Oh no, okay. Oh, there's something funky with my one then, but if it gives you an error, that there is not enough room. It's
I'll continue on because my camera decided to stop recording. If it gives you an error, you could just remove the last two null operations with no real thought to it.
So, if we go back to this, we have this hex file. Let me just compare. This one's slightly smaller for whatever reason. Doesn't matter. So you have the hex file. The hex file is what you burn to the ROM. If you have never used a ROM burner before, I'm not going to teach you. Look up your manual for your device while I plug this in and open this with my teeth. So, let's get this chip in. Let's drag on the hex file and let's burn. B for burn. Alright. Did it verify? Oh, sorry. B for blank check. What? W for write. I don't know what's wrong with me today. I'm fucking tired. Been up since 4 a.m. and it's 3:42. Writing takes a little while. If you have this particular burner, that one, this particular software, if you have some problems, erasing a previous chip or burning it and it doesn't verify, change your speed down to zero. It seems to fix some things. We wait patiently. While that's waiting, I'm going to find my little screwdriver, wherever that's gone. Fuck, I lose everything. This is why I need to clean. There it is. I'm just going to lift off my previous security IC. Do not use your fingers, you will wreck it.
The device is verified.
Okay, so. Now, unless you want to rip apart an old IC for this Naomi, you will need to take the cover off, which I have done. It's just shit. Drop the adapter. Looks like I have an email. Fuck it. I don't know where the cover is gone. You could figure it out. It's like two screws. You'll be fine. If you don't know much about ICs, a little notch down the bottom there, a little notch in that, that is the direction in which you want to do it. So, they usually make the chips a little bit too big, so you just, we'll just flatten it out a bit. Yeah, that should do it. Make sure it's the right way. Ugh. It's actually extremely hard to do with one hand, but that's in there. I think that's it. That's all you need to do. This has taken me about half an hour to explain. You could probably, with the soldering, you could probably do this in an hour. It's not awfully hard, but it's a bit of a bitch to do the soldering at least. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to put all this crap back together. It can go away. It can go in there. The main reason I didn't like this, so it's a cord, is just soldering onto one end is hard enough. Soldering onto two ends and keeping everything in the right direction is going to be super difficult. So, like that, just eliminates one avenue of failure. So I'll grab that. Grab my telephone, because why not? Grab the compact flash card. Now, if you're using this and you happen to set the slave switch to slave, set it back to master. You need to be on master, because there is only one device. And the SCSI thing only reads the first one. There's the cover. It's right there. So there's two screws there, a screw there, and maybe a screw there. Hope you could see all that. I couldn't see it myself. Let's grab that. Anyone see where I threw the Marvelous Capcom one? It's right there. And I'll bring this out just in case I fucked up the other security IC. I'm going to head out to the garage.
We're in the garage now.
Testing this stuff out. Now, my one, for some reason, takes a little while to load. It might be my NetDim. I don't really care. I'm patient enough. Now, one thing I will explain. This one does not have a battery in it. It's a very bad idea to try to lift it up while it's doing stuff. But under here, there's no battery. If there's a battery, it will not have to reload compact flash games. But, same with net booting. But what's the big deal? Who cares? If it has a battery, it has a battery. If it doesn't, it doesn't. I recommend removing them anyway, because they can leak. Now, I've left the screen as horizontal, haven't I? Oh, fucking idiot. So, if you want to know how to set it to horizontal, you got your test switch on the left, the service on the right. Hit test. Oh, fucking hell. I hit the wrong fucking button. Hit service to scroll. Oh, I'm a fucking idiot. Okay, so hit test again. You hit service to scroll. Go down to system assignments. Go to monitor type. Exit. As you say, it says game test mode Ikaruga because I just loaded up. And obviously the battery, the RAM didn't unload properly. So it's still picking it up as Ikaruga, that's fine. It shall reset it. Ugh. Hang on. It might be because this card, this flash card, is the Marvel vs. Capcom one that wasn't quite working properly. So we can test this together. If it doesn't work, I'll just fire back on the Ikaruga and I can show you that. See why it comes on and goes off again. The light flashes. If you know why this light flashes, let me know, because I have no fucking idea. It just flashes and it resets. See in a second, I guess. No? Make it look like it. There it went. Anyway. Wish I brought my Coke out here. I'm fucking thirsty from all this talking. So you can see my awful setup. There's no sound in the cab yet, because I haven't got amplified sound or stereo hooked up. Oh, I gotta rewire it, which I can't be bothered doing. One day, I'll do that. Alright, here we go. Yeah, so, I don't know why it doesn't like this card. At least the application doesn't, so we'll skip on that for now. And we'll plug in Ikaruga. So, I'm gonna recommend you don't get the Kingston ones, they don't seem to work. Fine. And the problem is I can't show you Marvel vs. Capcom, but I can show you sideways Ikaruga. Ikaruga is a shmup. Shoot 'em up. No, wait for it to load, and I have to change the assignments, otherwise it'll throw up an error, or a caution actually, but it doesn't let you proceed, so it's not really a caution, is it? Jeez, that wind is heavy. I'm leaning on my garage door, and it's pushing me, as you can probably see it moving. It's fucking weird. That was me. I don't know. It's probably more interesting than watching this thing turn on. There we go. No idea why my one takes so long. Okay, so let's go back into the test menu. And we'll go back to system assignments. Vertical, exit. Exit. And it should load up pretty freaking quickly. Probably get off the floor, I'm dirtying my jeans, but eh. Oh, I'll make it right way up for you guys at least. So as you can see, it's already skipped through half of the check memory and it's already through downloading. It's nearly there. This probably might not make anything any better for you guys, is it? Oh, maybe it is, I get confused with angles. If not, it's probably upside down, in which case I apologize. Basically, it resets and loads up the game. There will be no sound, but the buttons will kind of work, at least to the most of my cabinet's ability. Let's see if I can play this sideways, eh? Sideways and with one hand. Yep. Yeah. So it all works. As you can plainly see. Whee! Ah, what happened? Oh, whatever. Yeah. So that's it. That's everything you need to do to get a compact flash adapter working. Now, these are Toshiba brand cards, I believe. Not entirely sure. I bought them in a bulk lot off eBay quite a while ago. I don't remember what I wanted them for. Kingston ones. Naomi CF doesn't seem to read them properly. I'll give it another go off camera and I'll read back results. But yeah, that's everything. If you have any questions, feel free to ask in the comments, through Twitter, through Facebook, through YouTube PMs, whatever you like. That's it. I'm done. That's me signing off. Hope you've enjoyed this video and I'll catch you guys later.